Good evening and welcome to the lobby of the Francis Wilson Playhouse. I'm right here in front of a portrait of Francis Wilson himself in one of his iconic roles. Francis Wilson, if you don't know, was a famous actor on Broadway, and he was also the first president of the Actors' Equity Association and started in New York City. He had a winter home here in Clearwater, and he got a theater group to start, and they named it in his name. The theater company started in 1930 and built this theater, and it was opened in 1937, and we've been running here ever since. We're slowed down right now because of the current pandemic situation, but we've been doing these wonderful virtual concerts. This is the 9th one we've done since all this began, and in this one we're going to have many of our actors talk to you and talk to me about what it's like working here at the theater, and also do some songs from their iconic roles. So we hope you have a great time tonight. It's a little bit different format, but I think you're going to have a great time with this 30th anniversary. And it's the 30th anniversary of us doing musicals, because the theater started in 1930, but we didn't start doing musicals till 1991. We're going to tell you the story of that in just a moment, a little show called Very Good Eddie. So sit back, relax, and enjoy this look at 30 years of musicals at the Francis Wilson Playhouse. Now, if you've never been to the Playhouse opened in 1930, but existed for 61 years before they ever did a musical. They decided in 1991 to try their hand at doing musicals, and we've been doing them ever since. So we are doing a special concert tonight to celebrate 30 years of musicals here at the Playhouse, and I have a special treat for you tonight because we have the three stars of that original musical that played on our stage in 1991. We have Miss Susan Demers, Mr. George Kalitzis, and Mr. Dale Badway. And the name of that show from 1915 was
Very Good Eddie.
Very Good Eddie, a musical with the music of Jerome Kern. And it came about an interesting way. They had asked for a first show to try, and we tried to do a show called Good News, which was another classic show from the 1920s. And we had the auditions, and we didn't have enough people show up. It was bad news, yes. So we had to quickly change gears. And there'd been a very successful revival of Very Good Eddie done in the 1970s at the Goodspeed Opera House and on Broadway. And I looked into that and I said, well, this would be a smaller show with simpler sets. And I know the perfect people that might be able to do this. And that's how we wound up doing our first musical here as Very Good Eddie. The other choice of Very Good Eddie was also because Francis Wilson, who was an actor on Broadway in the 1880s, 1890s, and the early 1900s, it would have been a show that would have been from his era as well. So tell me, kids, how did you get involved in the show? How did you get involved in this very first musical here? And had you done shows at this theater before that?
Well, I had done shows at this theater, but they were always straight shows. And they were generally shows that had a single set. As a matter of fact, I think I was in one show where they had the audacity to suggest that there be two sets. And they said, no, no, no. So we fudged the single set. So the idea that we would do a musical, but the Prince's Theater musicals work really well because they have one set for the first act and a second set for the second act.
And that was also part of the thinking, was we have intermission to try to make a new set on the stage. And the first set of Very Good Eddie is on the boat that's going up the river to the Honeymoon Hotel, and then the second set was the Honeymoon Hotel itself. So you played Elsie Darling, correct? And if you don't know the plot of Very Good Eddie, it's about two couples who have just been married, and they're going to go for their honeymoon up to the Honeymoon Hotel. And each couple has a tall partner and a short partner. And the tall partner of the two, one woman, one man, harass and berate and belittle the shorter partner. And by chance, the two short people get stuck on the boat and the other two spouses miss the boat and they fall in love. And hilarity ensues after that. And you played Elsie Darling and the person you fell in love with, Eddie Kettle. And George, you played that role, correct?
Yes. I did.
And
it was fun.
We'd done a lot of shows together by then, though. Probably about 15, 20 years of shows by then, yes.
Right.
And Eddie is a very comedic role. One of his big songs is a song called 13 Collar, where he talks about being smaller than everybody else. And then, Dale, you played the young...
I don't really remember much because I played the role of young Eddie, and I was only 5 years old at the time. I'm just kidding. That's not true.
You played Dick Rivers.
Dick Rivers,
who is the young, handsome, swarthy leading man. And you would go on to play the young, handsome, swarthy man in Good News, which would be our second musical after Very Good Eddie.
Well, somebody said typecasting, but I will let that to the critics.
Because you also fall in love with a girl named Elsie in the show. And then there's a third character in Act Two whose initials are Elsie. So there's a lot of mistaken identity. There's a lot of hijinks. And eventually, the two couples don't want to be together. And they find out at the last minute by telegram that the Justice of the Peace didn't really have a license, so the weddings were null and void, and so everybody got to have a happy ending. So it's a fun little show. It was perfect for our first show because our audiences were expectant of something very unique and something very different. You told me a funny story, though, that one of the songs from the show haunts you to this day. Is that true?
Absolutely.
What's the song?
It is Bungalow in Quag.
Okay. Tell us a little bit more about
that. Yeah, so basically, you could say that Very Good Eddie is kind of a New York musical. It's New York State musical and not necessarily a New York City musical. But the song, Bungalow in Quag, will build a little bungalow in Quag in Yapank or in Hicksville or Pachog, where Hilda, our resourceful hen, will lay us omelets now and then as easily as falling off a log. I'm not going to subject you to the other nine verses.
That's the middle of the night song that you wake up to again and again.
Yeah. See, haunted.
I'm glad it made a good effect. Now, you've done shows since then. Correct? All of you have been in shows in the theater. What are some of the roles you've played in the years since Very Good Eddie here in our musicals?
I did the, The Preacher in, I can't think right now. Give me a second.
Edit? No. Well, Dale, what are some of the parts you played?
I would like to say I always was very honored. I love the Francis Wilson Playhouse here in Clearwater, Florida. It's iconic. Francis Wilson actually was the first president of Actors Equity. And when the theater opened under the name Francis Wilson, the Playhouse, telegrams came down from New York, and all of Broadway was abuzz about Francis Wilson's Playhouse here in Clearwater. And I didn't realize at the time that we were doing the very first musical. But to this day, I'm very honored to be among these wonderful performers and director. And it means a lot to me that as part of this 91 years of history, to be in the very first musical here. And I was very green at the time, as some may attest. And I learned so much here, and I think the theater plays an invaluable part, not only to the community, but to the theatrical world as a whole.
And you've done The Pirate King and Pirates of Penzance.
El Gallo and the Fantastics.
Thoroughly Modern Millie.
Trevor Graydon. Emile Dubec in South Pacific.
Most recently. And then what else? We did a couple of operettas. Marietta and Rosemary.
Yes.
And George, you were
Naughty Marietta.
You were Naughty Operetta.
Yeah. Naughty Marietta.
And what's her name? Jason Tucker was in the pit.
Yes.
And when we did this, it was a fugue almost. And I got it right. And then he went.
There you go. That's half the battle.
Right, yeah.
And Susan, you've done so many roles here, there, and everywhere.
Well, I like the ones where I get to make an entrance with luggage. And, and Very
Sounds
Good
like
Eddie
a lot
was,
of my dates.
Very Good Eddie was up there.
It was a luggage show, yes, along with Tintypes and, gosh.
I think you had luggage in 42nd Street.
I had luggage in 42nd Street.
Yeah, you had a whole
Street.
Number with luggage. So, yeah, that's sort of. But you've never played Pauline in No, No, Nanette, so.
Oh, you said the word.
I won't talk about that. So tonight, in honor of you being here and all the wonderful performers that are going to be here tonight, we're going to do three songs from Very Good Eddie. And I've asked some performers to learn them. And it's brand new to them, just like it was to us 30 years ago. The wonderful Drew Street is going to sing 13 Collars.
Good.
And then Cheyenne Haley is going to sing the very funniest song you got to do, the Left All Alone Again Blues.
Sitting on a suitcase.
Sitting on a suitcase. And last but not least, our own Francesca Guancial J is going to sing a little song called Katie Did, which for those of you that are here at the theater, Patty Baldwin, who was the leader of our First Nighters group, sang that song on our stage. Playing the opera singer in Very Good Eddie named Madame Matropo. So it's going to be a lot of fun to have them sing that. And thank you so much for being part of this tonight. Anything else you want to say about the Playhouse or about your experiences here?
I loved it. I love it. Straight play or musical, I love it.
Well, we could not do it without our actors. And we say that at the beginning of every audition. And we say that to them as often as we can because it is the actors that make the theater and our wonderful audience that'll be here tonight watching it. So
let me just add that from an actor point of view, it's a perfect stage to perform on because the audience is right there with you. And from the point of view of the audience, it's not that far to the stage. 200 and how many seats in this?
Not even as 186.
186. So you really are in the arms of the audience.
Yeah, the farthest seat back is about 42 or 43 feet from the stage.
Yeah. So. Great house to play in.
So we are so glad you're here, and this is going to be a fun night. We've got so much great music and so many great people coming through. So thank you, cast of Very Good Eddie, and we're going to go on to the next segment. In the show Very Good Eddie, Eddie complains about being mistreated because of his smaller size. In this song, 13 Collar, Drew Street tells us about his many woes.
I'm a peaceful little person, but peace is sometimes worse than all the wars combined that histories recall. I've been pushed around and kicked at, stepped upon, abused, and picked at, till I wonder if I'm anything at all. Even little flies that flutter from the sugar to the butter command respect because they carry germs. Their importance seems to teach us in this world of all-sized creatures, half are robins and the other half are worms. When you wear a 19 collar and a size 11 shoe, you can lead a pirate crew, smoke and drink and swear and chew, but you have to lock ambition up and throw away the key. When your collar's number 13 and your shoes are number 3. When we walk, my wife just kinda drags me by the hand behind her like a captive minnow on a dangling hook. And the passerby that spy me stop and pitifully eye me with that sympathetic, oh, that poor thing look. Every dog that I meet that's muzzled looks at me with such a puzzled air of injured pride and insolent disdain that I seem to gaze through leather, straps securely sewed together, and I feel Georgina tugging at the chain. When you wear a 19 collar and a size 11 shoe, bear and lion are a few of the names conferred on you, but you're classified with dachshunds, tiny palms, and Pekingese. When your collar's number 13 and your shoes are number 3. When you wear a 19 collar and a size 11 shoe, there's no indoor limit to all the great things you can do, but the world one big rat trap and you're just a piece of cheese. When your collar's number 13 and your shoes are number 3.
In the musical Very Good Eddie, Elsie Darling's husband literally misses the boat. And while she's on the boat, she sings this song about being left all alone again. It's called the Left All Alone Again Blues, and tonight, playing that role for our concert, is Cheyenne Haley.
it peeves me to be left here, flat here, just like a bump on a log. I sit on a log, no woman knows if she has a traveling husband just where he goes, unless she follows on and nails him, trails him, just like a faithful old dog. That old song, where has my Highland laddie gone? It says a mouthful, we never do know just where they do go. How they keep us guessing, isn't it distressing? I have the blues when my hubby leaves, although I wouldn't accuse. Each time he says goodbye, I get those same old left all alone again blues. I have the blues ever since he married me. I sure have the blues because I used to have a good time each time, every time I would roam. I said when I roam, when we first met, we could render a duet, but now hubby sings, I won't be home till morning, never one short stanza of home sweet home. I like cats, I'm fond of rabbits, I like dogs, and even goldfish. It's lucky maybe, for there's a baby grand piano coming, then I'll start a humming. I have the blues, only hubby dear can cure my terrible blues. Each time he says goodbye, I get those doggone left all alone again blues.
One more character in Very Good Eddie is a wonderful opera singer, Madame Metropo. She has a song in Act Two entitled Katie Did. And tonight, to do it for us, we have Francesca Guancial J.
Admit it.
Twice in our history, the theater has produced the wonderful show The Fantastics by Tom Jones and Harvey Schmidt. In our latest incarnation, Dale Badway played El Gallo, the narrator, and he opened the show with this immortal song. Our next guest tonight in our wonderful extravaganza is a dear friend of mine and somebody you've seen many times playing many wonderful roles here at the Francis Wilson Playhouse, Mr. Ed McNally.
Evening.
You've done so many great parts here. What are some of your favorites that you've gotten to do?
Xandar in Bells Are Ringing. Outstanding cast, outstanding role, a lot of comedy, a lot of room for improv. You know, physical improv was great. It was just this wonderful show. The sets, you know, I mean, it sold out.
That was back in 2007.
2008, that's a while.
2007.
Yeah, yeah. And then, of course, Thénardier in Les Miserables. You know, I got to play this great role, man. And once again, a lot of improv on the movement. The set was outstanding. And
51 people in the cast.
Yeah. I mean, 51, and a barricade that I could have put on my lawn and felt proud about, you know? And just everybody was tops. Everybody was tops. And, you know, we got to do a lot of stuff that a lot of people wouldn't let you do. And we had a good time with it.
What about Sweeney Todd?
Did you enjoy man, that I one? Love being in the back.
Yeah?
I love being in the back. You know, yeah. I mean, to me, the boards are the boards. If you're in the front, you're in the front. If you're in the back, you're in the back. You know, when you're in the front, you hear this wall of a chorus behind you. And at Francis Wilson, you always had 50 people, 40 people. So it was a wave that rushed over you. And it gave you motivation to really be good at what you were doing. But when you're in the back, you're supporting that person in the front, and it's like, yeah, yeah.
And your most recent role was Luther Billis in
Luther
South
Billis
Pacific.
In
and
South
you
Pacific.
Played that before, and what a character, what a character.
As a matter of fact, I think I think when I did South Pacific with the Clearwater Players, that's when you gave me the role of Xandar in Bells Are
Ringing. Exactly, 2007.
So I must have been good. But this time around again, I mean, you had this, well, you had Dale for one, you know, which is, he's a stand up, stand by all the time kind of guy. And playing opposite him and, you know, playing opposite Nelly, they were just great. The sets were great. The music is always great. Everybody's on cue, and you got a lot of people. And the Titanic.
Yeah, that's another big. You're in all the big shows. All the big shows.
I mean, the Titanic was a rush. Again, so many people with this outstanding set, outstanding costumes, outstanding vocals. Music was just, I mean, you really felt. You felt the Titanic. You really did. And, you know, Jason, and I know he's not swelling up his head here, he's probably the best director, performance director in all of Florida. I can't think of somebody better. And I've worked with a few. And not just because you're my friend, you know, because I love you, man. Well, you know, I mean, it's true. You. Jason says do this, you know you're supposed to do it. If Jason doesn't pick you to be in the front, get in the back. Get in the back. Sure. Then maybe one day you'll get to the front. And if not, stay in the back.
This was not a paid endorsement. In Lerner and Lowe's My Fair Lady, the character that always steals the show is Alfred P. Doolittle. The theater has produced the show twice in our history, and in the most recent version, Ed McNally played Alfred P. Doolittle and stopped Act One with this song, With a Little Bit of Luck.
Job and never shirk. The Lord above gave man an arm of iron, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, someone else will do the blinking work. With a little bit of luck, you'll never work. The Lord above made liquor for temptation to see if man could turn away from sin. The Lord above made liquor for temptation, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, when temptation comes, you'll give right in. With a little bit of luck, you'll give right in. Now you can walk the straight and narrow, but with a little bit of luck, you'll run amok. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, to share his nest and see his food is cooked. The gentle sex was made for man to marry, but with a little bit of luck, with a little bit of luck, you can have it all and not get hooked.
My next guest tonight is one of our most dynamic leading ladies, and she has just been a joy to work with in every single show she's done, Miss Lisa Prieto. We're glad to have you as part of our celebration.
Thank you.
Lisa, what was your first show that you did here?
My first show was Crazy for You,
which was
a Gershwin show that was so much fun, lots of tap dancing. I loved it, yeah.
And then you did choreography for Seven Brides for Seven Brothers.
Yes.
And then you played Lola and Damn Yankees and Cinderella and Into the Woods and all. What's been your favorite thing you've done so far? Or do you have a favorite?
I have a lot of favorites. I will say Lola was kind of my first big, I would say like a triple threat type of role, which is a lot of fun because it's like working a lot of different muscles throughout the show.
I
remember that was the first time I got to take the last bow of the show, which was really
That's
exciting.
True.
I think
true.
That means you sing the most songs, right?
Almost, yeah. And Gwen Burden would have gotten the last round,
right.
Of course. What you've also done a lot of our concerts.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a certain kind of song you like to sing in the concerts, or do you have a...
Well, I feel like two things. You give me a lot of songs that I've never heard before, which is always fun, because then I have that in my book, and it's like... I'll take that to an audition or I'll take that to another show and people are like, oh, I've never heard this song before, and it's really fun.
Like Comes Love was one you did recently.
Yeah. And I also, I feel like you give me a lot of torch songs and I really enjoy those, to be honest.
Oh, good. We enjoy the way you do them. Thanks. You just have an ease about you. Your performing is like a warm hug to the audience.
Oh, that's so nice.
It's true.
I might be more like a duck, like gliding on the surface, but just paddling like crazy underneath. No.
Lisa's terrific, and she's going to do a song for us tonight from Damn Yankees. Lisa Prieto has done many shows here at the Playhouse, but one of our favorites was when we did Damn Yankees and she played Lola. Whatever Lola wants, Lola gets. We know that. And how does she do it? Well, she does it with a little brains and a little talent.
Don't make me brag. I took the zing out of the King of Siam. I took the starch out of the sails of the Prince of Wales. It's no great art getting the heart of a man on a silver platter. A little brains, a little talent, with an emphasis on the latter. I made mincemeat out of a sweet young farmer. I knocked the fight out of a knight when I pierced his armor. And I'll bet I can upset every male in a Yale regatta. A little brains, a little talent, with an emphasis on the latter. You gotta know just what to say and how to say it. You gotta know what game to play and how to play it. You gotta stack those decks with a couple of extra aces. And this queen has her aces in all the right places. I've done much more than that old boar, Delilah. I took the curl out of the hair of the millionaire. There is no trick getting some hick who is cool just a little warmer. A little talent, a little brains, with an emphasis on the former. Down in Madagascar, ask me why weak men will die for me, strong men simply shatter. A little brains, a little talent, with an emphasis on the latter. You gotta know just what to do and how to do it. You gotta know what tea to brew and how to brew it. Says George Washington once slept here. Well, though nobody spied him, guess who was beside him? Bring on that boy, he'll be a toy to Lola. Just one more case she can erase with that old buffalo. A little this and a little that with an emphasis on the letter.
We have so many talented people that work with us, and this next person is one of my absolute favorites, Mr. Jerry Slutsky. We've done a lot of shows here, and just it's been an amazing thing. I met you many years ago before I worked with you here, and then I've seen you in shows here, and I've gotten the honor to direct you in shows here. What are some of your favorite memories of shows here at Francis Wilson?
Oh my God, the top show is Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, which I'm hoping to do a number for tonight.
Great.
But I did MAME, I did Grand Hotel. Way back before you were involved, I did Unsinkable Molly Brown, which
I saw
is another
that.
Song
yep.
that I'm going to do. And then there's one, 110 on the Shade.
Yes.
Which I had never done. So yeah. I think it's five shows over the past
unique show too.
Years.
Yeah, that's one of the things we pride ourselves on. We do shows that aren't always shows that get to be done. 110 in the Shade is a musical version of The Rainmaker by Jones and Schmidt. And you played File.
File.
Opposite Dale Badway, who was playing Starbuck and the lovely Kristen Rao, who's going to be here in this concert as well.
Oh, wonderful.
She's going to do a duet from Maine. So we all get to know each other, and it's part of the community section of community theater. Grand Hotel, that was a challenging show.
That was a big show in a small space.
Yes.
Yeah, I can't believe the choreography. You had us moving at all moments in that
yes.
show.
There are several people, including the president of our theater, who that was their favorite show of all time that we've done here. Andy just talks about Grand Hotel all the time, and it really was the right combination of people at the right time to pull it off. And that was a show I saw in New York right before it opened, and I went to see it again the next night and the next night, and I said, someday I want to do this show because I just loved it so much, and I'm very pleased with what we had with that production. And it's always a great thing. And one of the things about the intimacy of our theater is we do these big shows, we downsize it, but we don't downsize the voice or the acting or the talent.
Yes.
So it really gives the audience that same experience that I've had many people who saw a show in New York and didn't come to us on a regular basis and said, oh, I want to see that show again. And then suddenly said, I saw more nuance and more pieces of the show because of the closeness.
That's always one of the benefits. You really get intimate with the audience.
Right. And Scoundrels was another one that I had to really convince the board of directors to do, because I saw it in New York and thought it was one of the funniest shows I'd ever seen. And you played Lawrence in that,
mm-hmm.
opposite Nathan. Opposite Nathan, and you were both out of control. if you don't know that show, it's just one of the funniest musicals ever done, with a beautiful, wonderful, crazy score by David Yazbek. And we're going to have a song from that tonight from you and Nathan. I'm very excited about that as well.
I can't believe it's 10 years ago already.
10 years, but 10 wonderful years. 10 wonderful years. Any other insights you have about working at Francis Wilson?
I just have always enjoyed the intimacy of it. And what you've done with it from the first time I came here, you've replaced the seats, you've replaced the stage, you've replaced the sound system, the lobby area. It's like a brand new theater. And it's awesome, and I understand it's all paid for.
It is.
Unlike most community theaters, which are starving to survive, you've got it done. So, applause to you.
We're very proud of that.
Yeah.
After writing The Music Man, Meredith Wilson wrote a show called The Unsinkable Molly Brown, which we did here at the Playhouse. Playing Johnny Brown was none other than our own friend, Jerry Slutsky. Here he is singing one of Johnny Brown's songs, Colorado, my home.
Colorado, my home, sweet home. Hear yourself laugh and you'll laugh a lot more. Gives a man confidence, hollering in the mountains. Hey there, Rio. Hey there, Rio Grande. Where else, Rio, did you learn to roar? Well, I'll tell you, let me tell you, Rio, like me, you would be only a small-time trickle without the mountains of Colorado, my home, sweet home. When a man depends on all this elevation, he will never go away. Sky full of Rockies for my roof up there, a great golden meadow for my rocking chair, a claim and a cabin and some breathing air. Colorado, my home, and here till the judgment I will stay, here till the Ponderosa walks away, here where I'm proudest when I hear me say, Colorado, my home. Here where the silver finds you, together with the gold that will stick on your shoes. Missouri mules and plain damn fools may leave us for a little, but they'll all come back someday. There ain't seven wonders, only three. The mountains and meadows far as a man can see. And somewhere a Rocky Mountain gal for me. Colorado, my home. Colorado, my home.
Our next guest tonight is a dear friend of mine and one of the great leading ladies of the local stage, Miss Christina Capehart. We're so glad to have you here. And you've done some wonderful roles here at the Playhouse. What are some of the parts you played?
I was Annie in Annie Get Your Gun. I was Lucille in No, No, Nanette.
I remember that
one. We were married.
We were married, believe it or not. Yeah.
I was Adelaide in Guys and Dolls. I was Christina in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels.
You were Anytime Annie in
42nd Street. I was Anytime Annie. It's a popular name for me. And then I was in, what's the one that we did? It was six of us and we were in
A Gray. Day in Hollywood, a Night in the Ukraine. Yes.
My favorite one.
And you've done many concerts with us. And
kids shows.
Yeah, a lot of stuff. Well, it's a lot of fun, and we always have a great time. And Christina has not only performed here, she's traveled with me to New York to do cabaret shows there and such. And you give so much as a performer, and that's what everybody loves about you. What can you take from your experiences here at the Playhouse? What are some of your good memories of the performances you've done here?
I think that Frances Wilson just always feels like family, right? Like, you're such a great leader, and you really kind of create community, which is what we are, community theater. And everyone here is growing. We have a lot of really young folks here who grew up in the theater, go on to do bigger and, you know, paid things and
things that
are, you know, in college. And I think that's a really beautiful thing, and it's such a special little gem here. It's so small, much smaller than some of the other theaters. So you get that, like, really kind of special connection with your audience, and you get a special connection with your cast. I mean, it's really a one-of-a-kind experience, and nothing compares to it.
Well, one of my favorite roles of yours, and I've liked them all, I love them all, was Annie Oakley in Annie Get Your Gun. And it's a great part, not just because it's well-written and she gets lots of great songs, but she gets to really have a transformation as the show goes on, and she becomes empowered and everything else and can hold her own against you-know-who. Frank Butler. But there's a beautiful song that she sings in a boat, on a boat in the beginning of Act Two, and it's my favorite song from the show, and I told you that when we did the show. And the other day when I asked you to come sing, I said, can you do it again? And it's a song by Irving Berlin, music and lyrics, called I Got Lost in His Arms. So would you do it for us tonight?
I don't think I have a choice, so yeah.
There we go. Irving Berlin's Annie Get Your Gun was a huge hit for the theater, and our Annie was played by none other than Christina Capehart. Here she sings her Act Two ballad, I Got Lost in His Arms.
I said
kept jumping all around. I got lost, but look what I found.
Now, some of our actors are not here in the area right now. They're in other parts of the country. And I want to talk to one of them. And this is a young actress by the name of Amy Morris, who's done many leading roles with us and even supporting roles. She works for the United Nations School in New York City. And we asked her via television, whatever you want to call it, to talk to us. So I've got a couple questions for her. And Amy, here's the first question we have for you is, what makes Frances Wilson special for you?
Frances Wilson is special to me because fairly certain I saw my first community theater show a long time ago when I was at Clearwater High School, and everybody was so talented, and I was like, oh, one day I'm gonna be brave enough to go and audition for a show there. And yeah, then like 15 years later, I was finally brave enough. Thanks to Jason and for giving me a part.
Question number two. What are some of your favorite roles that you've played at the Playhouse?
Oh, I have so many favorite roles from my time at Frances Wilson Playhouse. First has got to be the very first role I ever had there, which was Peggy Sawyer, who is the lead in 42nd Street. And for a tap dancer like me, that was a dream come true to be able to play that role. I also have had the great pleasure of starring opposite the preeminent Frances Wilson Playhouse player, Kurt Golick. He and I played opposite each other in Pajama Game, and that was a riotous good time. He is always trying to make people laugh on stage. We had a blast doing that show. And then, oh gosh, so many favorite roles. So we also, Frances Wilson, several years ago now, did my favorite show of all time, which is Crazy for You. And I was fortunate enough to get to play two roles in that show, because our lead had to step away for her brother's wedding for a weekend, and I got to step in and actually play the lead. So I got to play the comic relief character of Patsy, the ditzy blonde girl who's like, ooh, all the time and bopping around. And then for one night only, I got to play the lead in Crazy for You, which is my all-time favorite musical, another tap dance musical. And that was a memory I'll never forget. Oh, such a great show. What else? Other favorite roles. Oh my goodness, there's been so many. Okay, so we can't let this moment pass talking about favorite roles without talking about the two times I've had the pleasure of starring opposite Michael Silvestri. I cannot say enough words about how much I love this man. We played opposite each other. Actually, we met each other at Curtains, which was the first show we did together, and we played opposite each other, and he was Detective Chaffee, and he was amazing. The entire show revolves around his character's just interest and silliness and willingness to just be like the butt of the joke and center stage. Oh gosh, he was so great. It was so wonderful. And then we got, the next year, we got the opportunity to play opposite each other again in Nice Work If You Can Get It and Dance Together Again, which, oh, so magical. Yeah, those are some of my favorite roles.
And now, live from New York City, Amy Morris sings a song from the musical Lucky Stiff, in which Annabelle Glick talks about the true love of her life. The song is called Times Like This.
All I have to say is, I am happy to be sitting here doing what is meaningful to me.
times like this a girl could use a dog. He listens when you tell him things. There's nothing he can't say. And unlike certain people, you can teach him how to
having so much fun tonight with all these wonderful performers, and this next person is one of my absolute favorites, a man that I worked with when many years ago, and they came back into our lives to entertain us here on the stage, Mr. Michael Silvestri. How are you doing?
Doing well. How are you?
Very well. Our audiences know you from many parts. What are some of your favorite roles you've done here at the theater?
I would have to say Chaffee in Curtains is probably my favorite. That's a role that I could just go on the road with.
Curtains is a musical murder mystery, if you haven't seen it, and he plays a detective who not only solves the crime, but also fixes the show that's in trouble out of town because he loves musical theater on the side.
And so much fun. I love that role.
Yeah.
Nice work if you can get it. That was a fun show as well.
Again, all those Gershwin
songs. Working with Amy, and you know I like the old stuff. So.
Exactly. What is unique about doing a show here at the Francis Wilson Playhouse for you?
For me, I like the smaller house. I like being close to the audience. I like that energy that they provide. In some theaters, they're so far away. And this is just more intimate. The history of the place, you've got a strong season holder following, season ticket holder following that's our regulars here, and they're used to seeing a certain type of caliber show, and I think what you've been able to do in the course of a 12-month period, this is amazing. I mean, it helps to have the rehearsal space in the back, absolutely, but there's just an intimacy and just a camaraderie, and working with the family here is a really nice experience.
Curtains was a murder mystery musical with music by John Kander, lyrics by Fred Ebb and Rupert Holmes. We had a ball with this whodunit musical. And our very own detective in the show was played by Michael Silvestri. Here he talks about the life of being a homicide detective in Boston with a song called Coffee Shop Nights.
I love my job. I really do. And if I say so myself, I'm good at it too. I catch the bad guys, well, most of the time. So it's a good life, a perfectly good life, not exactly sublime. When I've finished my work and I crawl into bed, I reflect as I turn out the light, that the day that's to come and the week that's ahead will be lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. Lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. I like my pals, the guys on the force. We're not very social, they're all married, of course. Sometimes we go bowling or have a few beers. So it's a fine life, a perfectly fine life. I give it two cheers. 'Cause sometimes I think at the end of the day, when I've read The Last Burglar his rights, that the life that I lead is a little bit gray, with its lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. Lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights. This life that I lead, that's a little bit gray. There are plenty of low days and not many highs. Mostly lunch counter mornings and coffee shop nights.
All right, now our next interviewees tonight are actually a married couple, our only ones that are actually married together, not just acting like they're married. And you were married.
We're just acting. We are. Just
you were married on the stage of the Francis Wilson Playhouse, correct?
Wait, who's married?
Yeah, two of you.
Yes, of course.
It's funny, actually. There's so, because of how many roles we've played here in different things, people think that I'm married to about 12 different women.
Well,
which, yeah, you know,
that would be big of you, or big of me. Anyway.
Oh boy.
So. All right, we're going to do a song from one of my favorite shows you did. They're playing our song. But what have been some of your favorite parts here at the Playhouse?
I really liked Ilona in She Loves Me.
Oh, yeah.
I liked The Baker's Wife in Into the Woods. I liked Edwin Drood in The Mystery of Edwin Drood. So there have been a lot of fun ones.
What about you, Nathan?
As for me, I think my favorite one that I've done here so far is probably The Baker. And then Freddie in Chess, and probably Freddie in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. And that was my very first one here, was Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, 10 years ago.
For both of you, that was your first
yeah,
show, both
very
of you.
First
and that was
here.
10 years ago.
10 years
at this
ago.
Point.
Which
right
I cannot believe.
That?
Wow. And there are some people actually I saw on Facebook that said that they saw that first production 10 years ago and have been following and have been, you know, seeing all the shows since then. So.
Well, here's the other question for you. You're the musical director for our concerts.
Yeah.
How many concerts? What concert number is this, and how many of them have you done?
This is concert. This one actually, right now, the one we're doing right, it's concert number 59.
Okay.
And I've done 49 of them.
49.
So there's only 10 concerts that we've done in the entirety here that I've not done. So.
And there's one person that's done all 59,
and that's me.
And I'm still standing.
We'll bring you on with like an iPad on a screen if you're in a hospital bed. Like, you'll be at every single one.
But we do the concerts throughout the year when the theater's open. We do 4 a year, and then for this special time, we're doing them monthly, and this is our special 30th anniversary of doing musicals here at the theater. So what makes performing here different than other venues that you might have worked at?
I wouldn't know. I've done no other shows at any other venues.
No, you have. You've done a couple, yeah.
Only a few, and I don't know, probably just the welcoming atmosphere. Everybody's very much team player here. Everybody's rooting each other on to do a good job and do well. And not that other places don't do that, but it's just there's a sense of family here that I don't really get anywhere else.
I think some of our lifelong friends we met here.
Mm-hmm.
like honestly, that we met when we started doing shows here 10 years ago. And throughout that process, we've made like some of our lifelong friends, including you and lots of other folks that you'll see on screen. In the
show tonight. My final question is, they're playing our song. We're going to have you do a couple songs from that show. And that was sold out before it even opened. Amazing.
That was crazy. And I was very shocked because I know Neil Simon shows and you know, and Marvin Hamlisch.
Boggled my mind because I hadn't heard of it prior to doing the show. Yeah. And I was like, how popular can it be? And turns out extremely.
Yeah. When we sold out prior to opening night and we had to add two other performances
to the run.
That was crazy. And I had never heard about it. Just like Taryn, I didn't really know about the show.
That Marvin Hamlisch, Carol Bayer Sager, Neil Simon. Mm-hmm. Funny show. And also a small show.
Yeah.
Only 8 people in it. And you played the two characters. And then the other 3 girls and the 3 men played your alter egos in the show.
89 pages.
89 pages. Oh.
And of a Neil Simon show, so it's very wordy.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of lines to memorize. It was a beast.
And we only had, 3 weeks, 4 weeks to learn it completely and fully. And
I remember we actually went on a little vacation over Christmas because this was in January of 2016. And we took a Christmas vacation to visit his parents in Alabama. And we were studying lines together in the car there and on the car ride.
Exactly.
That's how we learned it.
Well, it was terrific, and everybody loved it. And if we did it again, they'd love it again. Our production of They're Playing Our Song sold out before the show even opened. It had music by Marvin Hamlisch, lyrics by Carol Bayer Sager, and a book by Neil Simon. Our 2 stars were Nathan Dougherty and Taryn Holzhauer, who are married in real life and were actually married on the stage of our Playhouse. They're going to sing 2 songs for you now from the show. The title song, called They're Playing Our Song, and then a beautiful ballad from Act 2, which Taryn will sing, entitled I Still Believe in Love.
Oh my goodness! You hear that? The song that she is playing? That's my very first big hit! Oh, they're playing my song. Oh yeah, they're playing my song. And when they're playing my song, everybody's gotta don't say a word now, listen to that sweet melody. I'm happy to say in my own humble way, every perfect note of that was written by me. Oh, they're playing my song, that table's humming along. That couple half out the door is coming back to hear more of my music. At first I thought this place was a dive. I chose it in haste, but it shows they got taste. As long as they're playing my song, who would have known 9 months ago I would give birth at my piano? In all honesty, I've got to admit, I knew this song would be an international hit. Oh, they're playing my tune, too bad it's ending so soon. But when it's all time to go, it's good to know that they'll be playing. Oh God, I'm praying they'll keep playing. They'll keep playing my song. See what you got.
Oh, and this is one of mine.
Okay.
Oh, they're playing my song. Oh, yeah, they're playing my song. And when they're playing my song, everybody's gotta shh, shh, shh. The magic of words is weaving its spell around this room. Nobody's dancing, they're all too entranced in just the perfect way my words fit that tune. Right now they're listening to me. My lyric reads like a poem. It surely stands on its own. It makes me proud to hear that music. It's a total expression of me. To be more specific, this place is terrific. As long as they're playing my song. Who would have known that 2 years ago when Leon asked, can't loving be fun? Who would have known, can't loving be fun, would be sung by everybody under the sun. You know it made the top 10, all good things come to end. I wish they play it again and again, they keep on playing.
Oh God, I'm praying they'll keep playing my
I've cried. You'd think I would give up on love again.
it off the slide. Maybe I might get it right this time. I was there as passion turned to pain, sunshine turned to rainy days. Here I am, ready to begin once again. All my life I've been a dreamer, dreaming dreams that always broke into. But I still believe in love, and love believing. Maybe you can make my dreams come true. I know I've made myself a friend. All my life I've been a dreamer, dreaming dreams that never quite came true. But I still believe in love, and love believing. I'll keep on dreaming, because I still believe in love. I still believe in love, and me and you. I still believe in love.
I hope you are having a great time tonight. We've had a great time talking to all these performers. We've got even more coming up in the second half of our production tonight. And I just want to remind you that we are a nonprofit organization. And while we're stalled and not able to open to the public, we would welcome any donations from you or anyone else to help keep us going, because we are trying desperately to keep everything going here and be ready for the day they give us the green light that we can open again. You can do it through Venmo, you can do it through our website, or you can send an old check, or if you want to bring something here to the theater, I'll meet you here and we'll take it, an old TV set, whatever. I'm kidding about that. But we are so happy for any and all donations, and it really does help us keep things going. We're in the same boat as Broadway, Ruth Eckert Hall, many other places are having the same sort of thing, so it's not unlikely, but we would like to open soon, but we have to wait until we can do it safely and officially too. So any donations you can make, it's great, and we love that you're taking part in our concerts. If you haven't seen the other ones, we have several online on this same YouTube channel, and we'd love for you to see those as well. So sit back, relax, and we're going to have more of the show right now. One of the most important parts of our backstage and training, our rehearsals, is the music. And tonight we have two of our great musical directors here in the show. Nathan, who you heard interviewed and you heard him singing, but also Miss Emmy Stefanov, who gets to do a lot of our shows, and she trains everybody how to sing it and how to do it. And tonight she's accompanying everybody on the piano. What are some of your favorite moments in doing these shows? What's been like one of the most exciting shows we've done for you musically to teach? Or
the most exciting show? Well, I personally loved Fantastics, and obviously that's because I got to play the show. But the cast was fantastic, haha. And I loved having the harp there with me. Damara was fantastic as well, all puns intended. My favorite probably was Les Mis at some point in time, Into the Woods. It's one of my favorite shows of all time, so anytime you want to do that again, we can.
Yeah. Secret Garden was another one.
Oh, Secret Garden was tons of vocals. I mean, but Joseph was tons of vocals, so
shows. But what's it like when when the cast comes in? You get a cast, because we're community theater, you'll get people from trained singers to people that don't know what those specs are on the page. How do you address that? How do you attack that as a musical director, as a teacher?
You start from scratch. It helps that I'm a teacher, so you just start from scratch and you teach the notes. We spend good week in like just doing the notes, and I just play every single note and everybody records it and we learn it, and eventually we start doing it with me playing the accompaniment, and about like a couple weeks in we end up doing with tracks, which is always exciting because the first time the tracks come in, everybody hears the orchestration and everybody forgets every single thing that they learned because it's just exciting, you know. But yeah,
it's good. That's good. Well, you've been with us for many years. What was your first show here at the Playhouse?
I want to say it was Seven Brides, was it? I think that was like, that was our first show here. We did other stuff before that, but that was the first show here.
Seven Brides, you've done so many.
Every season it's been a lot of them.
Is there one musical moment, one song that stands out from all the rest that got you every single time you heard it, every time you heard them sing it or perform it?
Performing wise, it was in Titanic. The end of I literally just got goosebumps. The end of Titanic when they sang and you know they're all saying goodbye and like the ghosts are meeting and just in that moment, like, it just tears every single time.
Yeah, me too every time.
It was a great moment.
And that's one of the reasons in 1991 the theater wanted to do musicals, because they'd done plays, they'd done mysteries and all kinds of things, and they never thought they could. And it became a learning process and how to do it.
Yeah.
And one of the things we've proven over the years that you can do a really big show on a smaller scale and still not only pull it off, but also sometimes you'll show people new layers to the show. And they'll hear new things with the music and see new things because it is intimate. A lot of people loved our Les Mis because they could see everything that was happening in the story. And they felt like they were in the middle of it.
Yeah.
So. It's a great thing. Well, we thank you for all the time and effort you put in. And Nathan as well. He does all of our concerts and he's done so many of our shows as well. And we start with the top and we come in with a good attitude and the training, and everybody else loves that. And again and again tonight, if you've heard the interviews, you'll hear a lot of people saying it's like family. And we don't yell and scream. We try to build it up and build everybody up. And you know, as I often say to the performers, because they do come in with a wide range of ability or
training
that we're only as strong as the weakest link, as the person that knows the least. And we want everybody to look good in their dancing and their singing and their acting. And you've been a great part of that. And we try to set that up from the first moment of the audition all the way through to the closing night. So I thank you.
And my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Your music is terrific. Thank you.
The colors of my life are bountiful and bold. The purple glow of indigo, the gleam of green and gold, the splendor of a sunrise, the dazzle of a flame, the glory of a rainbow, I'd put them all to shame. No quiet browns and grays, I'll take my days instead and fill them till they overflow with rose and cherry red. And should this sunlit world grow dark one day, the colors of my life will lead a shining light to show the way. About 15 years ago, we decided to put on this wonderful show called Barnum. Barnum tells the story of P.T. Barnum as done with a circus. And I had the wonderful honor to get to play Phineas Taylor Barnum in that show. And we had an amazing cast. And people learned how to juggle and do acrobatic tricks and swing on the high rope and all that sort of thing to make the show work. And it was a great success for us. And it was a wonderful experience to sing this song by Cy Coleman and Michael Stewart. No quiet browns and grays, I'll take my days instead and fill them till they overflow with rose and cherry red. And should this sunlit world grow dark one day. The colors of my life will lead a shining light to show the So many of our performers at the theater are come back for show after show, and we build friendships that last for many years. And this is one of my dearest friends from the theater, a man named Mr. Rick Kistner. We've done so many shows together.
Yes, sir.
What was the first show we worked on? It was not here. It was somewhere. Well, Showboat. Was
Showboat
that the first
at,
one?
at Ruth Eckert Hall.
Okay.
1993.
And we played opposite each other on the stage, and I've been
several
out
times,
the
yeah.
front. We did one of our favorites here at the Playhouse. You might have seen it a few years ago, My Fair Lady. I got to play Henry Higgins, and this was our Colonel Pickering. And years earlier, Rick had played Henry Higgins in a production I did down at the Tides
Dinner Theater.
So what's different about playing at this theater? You've done a lot of parts here. What do you like about the Francis Wilson?
I like the family atmosphere. I mean, this is like my second home. It really is. Every time I have an opportunity to do any kind of production up here, I'm going to know the people. I'm going to know many of the performers. It's old home week. But what's also really special to me is to watch so many of the youngsters who have gone on to do many, many greater things. And that's been one of my favorite things throughout my performing career, is to watch people as youngsters doing community theater shows, going on, being on in Broadway productions, mm-hmm. and national tours and that sort of thing. And I love the opportunity to say I knew him when, or I knew her when.
Right. So what have been a few of your favorite roles here at the Playhouse?
Oh, every one of them.
Okay.
I just love doing this. Favorites include Fagin
and Oliver,
yeah. Horace Vandergelder, and Hello, Dolly. I've done that for you twice.
Yes.
Of course, Colonel Pickering here, Ed Earl in Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. Every one of them.
And you were part of the musical that was written about the life of Francis Wilson.
I played Francis Wilson in the original musical, Francis Wilson the Musical.
By Gil Pilroth.
That's right. So that was a lot of fun. But as I say, when you've done as many as I have, it's really hard to pick out a favorite.
It is. It's been a hard question for everybody
so far
I've asked. We had a rootin' tootin' time here at the Playhouse with a musical called The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas, with music and lyrics by Carol Hall. Playing our sheriff was none other than Rick Kistner, and he's going to sing a song for us now entitled Good Old Girl.
Well, she's a good old girl. So long, long miles together, and thank the Lord she never was the clinging kind. But she's a good old girl. We've had some fine big laughs together, and I admired the way she almost read my mind. Never talked, no foolish talk, had no ties and held no rules. You see, that good old girl and me, we ain't damn fools. You know, we never talked too much. We didn't hold to conversation. There's lots of things I could have told her, I suppose. But what I would want to tell that good old girl, she knows.
Well, now I'm going to talk to two of my favorite people. These are not just actors at the theater. These are like my family members here. There's Miss Sherry Albury and Miss Kristen Rowell. And
Tell me when your first experience was here at the Francis Wilson Playhouse. Can you go back and think about when you first were on this stage?
The first time I was on this stage, I was 8 in I Remember Mama, and it was directed by Dorothy Ellison. And
so just a few years ago.
Yeah, just a few years ago. Just like yesterday. And then I did The Crucible here when I was in high school and went away to school and came back here with my children. And the first show that we did together here was Annie, Get Your Gun.
Yes, yes. And many, many since then, including being husband and wife this past year in a two-person musical called I Do, I Do. And that was quite an experience in and of itself. And then Sherry... I knew you many years doing shows before you came to Francis Wilson, but what was your first performance here?
My first performance here was Naughty Marietta.
Okay. Were you opposite James Grinnell in that?
Yes, I was.
Yeah. You were the comic relief. Girlfriend.
We were the comic relief. That's usually what I am, comic relief.
Yes. And
the first show I ever saw here, though, I was only probably about 10. It was Murder at the Vicarage.
Oh, I saw that too.
It was very good. The set was fabulous.
Agatha Christie, I saw that because I had just done a show here as a kid. And I said, I want to see other shows here. Because the theater, as I said earlier in the show, has been open. The theater company has been going since 1930. But musicals didn't start here till 1991. And that's why we're doing the 30 years of musicals. But you guys have both done many plays here too.
That's
and
true.
Musicals and things. So what is your favorite role or some of your favorite roles you've played here at the Playhouse for both of you?
Oh gosh.
I don't know. That's a hard question.
Well, we've done a lot of great shows here. So there's actually quite a few to pick from. I would say some of my favorite are Mrs. Lovett from Sweeney Todd. Because that was a very good challenge, as well as being a wonderful show. Leading player in Pippin.
Oh, yes.
That was a lot of fun. I've always wanted to play that role, and circumstance created the opportunity to do
that.
What
about Madame Thénardier
and
Les Mis?
And Madame Thénardier, yes, in Les Mis, a beautiful musical. And those are some of my top ones. And Vera Charles in Mame.
Yeah,
I played with Kristen. She was the lead. I was her best friend.
It's funny because a lot of our favorite roles, we ended up being in the same show together.
That's true.
And Mame is probably my favorite of all of them, but also Fantine and Millie and Seven Brides, but Fastrada in Pippin.
See?
And...
Also, you were both in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, right?
Yes, we were both in that.
Were.
And we were both in A Flea in Her Ear, which was also fun.
Yes,
which
not,
was
not a musical,
a musical.
but a play.
Here's my final question. What's unique about the Francis Wilson experience as a performer? What's unique to you about this place?
I'll go first. I think that the entire setting, I mean, first of all, it's a beautiful theater, and it's just the perfect size, in my opinion. We've both been in bigger venues like Ruth Eckert Hall and things, but honestly, it's so big, you don't feel like you're really interacting with the audience as much. On a slightly smaller scale like this is 180 some seats. Mm-hmm. You know, you can actually see people, first of all, which is nice, but we have all these wonderful season ticket holders that come back time after time, and when you've done enough shows, they become your family. So you really do feel like you're performing for a bunch of friends, and that makes it very, very special.
I would have to agree. It's like the family you choose.
Exactly.
but the performers and the audience. And my kids feel the same way. Cause
your kids grew up here.
They did.
They did.
And so it was a great place to have them grow up.
And your kids are all performers now.
They are.
Yeah, as near adults. Adults and near adults.
Adults and near adults, yes.
So it is a family thing, both in the chosen theater family and also real families, too. We have a lot of people. You have all three children in shows with you, mm-hmm. and we have that with many of the families here. And it's just a fun part of what we do, because the community of community theater is both on stage, backstage, and also with the audience, too. Jerry Herman's musical Mame was a sellout hit for the Playhouse. We now do two songs from that show. The first is a duet between Mame and her friend Vera, and the second is a solo for Mame. In our production, we had none other than Christian Rau playing Mame Dennis, and as her friend and great actress, Vera Charles, the one and only Sherry Alberry.
We'll always be bosom buddies, friends, sisters, and pals. We'll always be bosom buddies. If life should reject you, there's me to protect you. If I say that your tongue is vicious,
if I call you uncouth,
it's simply that who else but a bosom buddy will sit down and tell you the truth. Though now and again I'm aware that my candid opinion may sting,
though often my frank observation might scald. I've been meaning to tell you for years you should keep your hair natural, like mine.
If I kept my hair natural like yours, I'd be bald. But, darling, we'll always be dear companions, my crony,
my mate.
We'll always be harmonizing, Orphan Annie and Sandy, like Amos and Andy. Say that your sense of style is as far off as your youth. It's simply that who else but a bosom buddy will sit down and tell you the truth.
Each time that a critic has written, your voice is the voice of a frog. Straight to your side to defend you, I rush. You know that I'm there every time that the world makes an unkind remark. When they say Vera Charles is the world's greatest lush, it hurts me.
If I say that your fangs are showing maim, pulling your claws, it's simply that who else but a bosom buddy would notice the obvious flaws.
I feel it's my duty to tell you it's time to adjust to your age. You try to be peg of my heart when you're Lady Macbeth. Exactly how old are you, Vera? The truth.
How old do you think?
Oh, I'd say somewhere in between 40 and death.
But, sweetie, I'll always be Alice Toklas if you'll be Gertrude Stein. And though I'll admit I've dissed you, I've gossiped and gloated, but I'm so devoted.
And if I say that sex and guts made you into a star, it's simply that who else but a bosom buddy will tell you how rotten you are. Just turn to your bosom buddy for aid and affection, for help and direction, for loyalty, love, and forsooth. Remember that who else but a bosom buddy will sit down and level, will give you the devil, will sit down and tell you the truth. Where's that boy with the bugle? My little love, who was always my big romance. Where's that boy with the bugle? And why did I ever buy him those damn he need a stronger hand? Did he need a lighter touch? Was I soft or was I tough? Did I give enough? Did I give too much? At the moment when he needed me, did I ever
turn away? Would I be there when he called? If he walked into my life today, were his days a little dull? Were his nights a little wild? Did I overstate my plan? Did I stress the man? I never really found the boy before I lost him. Were his years a little fast? Was his world a little free? Was there too much of a crowd, all too lush and loud?
The theater had a great hit with Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, with music and lyrics by Stephen Sondheim. We now have a song from Act Two of Sweeney Todd, played by our very own Mrs. Lovett, Sherry Albury.
By the sea, Mr. Todd, it's the life I covet. By the sea, Mr. Todd, oh, I know you'd love it, you and me. Swan to a strait from the straits of Bering. Every night in the kip, when we're through our kippers, I'll be there slipping off your slippers by the sea with the fishy splashing by the sea. Wouldn't that be smashing? I can hear us awaken. Breaking the seagulls squawking, ooh, I do me bacon, then I'd go walking with you, ooh, I'd roll me bones by the Esplanade, have tea and scones with my gay young blade, then I'd knit a sweater, why you'd write a letter, unless we got better to do. Seaside wedding could be divine.
butter the moment I mutter I do. By the sea in our nest we could share our kippers with the odd paying guest. From the weekend trippers have a nice sunny suite for the guest to rest in. Now and then you could do the guesting by the sea.
Tonight, in our wonderful evening of stars of the Francis Wilson Playhouse, we have two of my favorite people. We have Mr. Dave Davis, and we have Mr. Stu Sanford. And these guys, you've seen them on our stage many times. And one of the things that's interesting to me is they played opposite each other a couple times in the Fantastics and also in the Sweeney Todd. And what's it like playing off of each other in these shows?
Well, there's just a lot of abundant material to work with Stu.
Yeah,
I mean, he's very, very dramatic, very forceful, and it's a good energy that I can feed off of.
Yeah, Dave has a really good character playing as an actor. I'm able to work off of him, and working is the with the Fantastics. We were basically two opposites. And once again, in Sweeney Todd, we were really opposites.
Exactly. Yeah. So. And you got to kill him every night, right?
Every night. Yeah. And twice on every Sundays. Night.
twice on every other, the second Saturday.
Yeah, right. Scary stuff. Some of our audience were spooked to death with that show, but we loved it. Sweeney Todd was one of my favorites that we had to do. And he was a Sweeney, and he played the evil Judge Turpin, the guy that sent Sweeney up the river. What are some other fun things you've done here at the Playhouse? I know you both have done a lot of parts.
Yeah, let's see. Then we were both in Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, I was Potiphar / Pharaoh, and you were the grand.
Jacob.
I was Jacob.
Jacob with all those sons, all those many, many sons.
Another musical such as our favorite, which was Titanic.
Yeah, you did Titanic last year. Oh, my gosh.
That was so, I mean, you could feel it.
Yes.
Yeah, that was a great show. Mm-hmm. And then at another theater, Stu and I were both in Jesus Christ Superstar.
I remember that, yeah.
Yeah, I was Pilate.
And we were against Caiaphas. Each other again, weren't we?
I wouldn't say against. I mean, you were using me to, you know, to Jesus.
Was, yeah.
And, you know, so yeah. It's been five shows that we've been in together.
I was thinking the other night, and I said, what, how many shows? That's four? And, oh, yes.
Yeah, and then you count
but
the other one.
We're talking about Francis.
Francis.
Exactly. Francis. Well, that's okay. Yeah, that's right. Okay.
It all comes back one to big thing.
But what makes performing at this theater special? What makes it a unique experience for you?
It's a great, it's an intimate place, for one thing. I mean, you stand up there, and there's so many things that can be done with this stage. You know, I just think of a show like Into the Woods, where, I mean, this stage, which, you know, we do a bazillion and one shows on, was like so deep and so multi-level. There's a lot of things that can be done with it.
Yeah, as you said, it is the theater, and I think it's also the, let's call it the home feeling here. Mm-hmm. It really is.
Yeah.
You are close to the audience, and the audience, and it's funny, you get to see a lot of the same audience participants.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
They come and they want to see what can you do now.
Exactly.
And sometimes they say, well, where's the regular crew?
Well, sometimes that's a compliment. If they didn't realize they'd seen you before because you were so immersed in a role.
Right, right.
Now, we'll have people call the box office and say, is so-and-so in this show or whatever. And everybody loves doing the Joyed It line out here. Mm-hmm. And if you don't know what a Joyed It line is, that's where they come out and shake the actor's hands. And everybody says, Joyed It. But these guys are great. They bring so much. And not only do they bring so much energy and humor and drama when it's needed, but also they both have amazing voices. And that's one of the things we pride ourselves on, is that when we do a Broadway show that requires technically difficult singing, we have people that come out to do it that sound like they would be on Broadway. They have these voices and they have this talent. And we are very blessed, as I said at the beginning of our broadcast tonight, to have the talent. And I try to start every audition here telling the people that are coming to audition, we need you. we need you on our stage to make us look good, and you make us look good. And to think about the blockbuster shows that we've done just in the last few years, like Les Miserables and Sweeney Todd and this and that. I mean, Titanic. And so many times I'm greeted with derision saying, you can't put that on that stage. It says, we will, and we'll do it, and you'll love it.
Watch us.
And I've had friends who saw some of these shows in bigger theaters and loved how it was right in their lap. It was right there. The story was right there. And they could, you know, live and die and laugh and cry with the actors in the story, whereas in a bigger venue, they felt like it was something very distant. Right. So I thank you both for being a part of our history, and we're going to start our history again.
Since this is a celebration, I hope we go on with you for many, many years.
Yes, yes.
Both of us, God willing.
Yes. All right, well, thank you. We're going to hear a song from them in just a moment. It's going to be terrific. So thank you both, and we're going to go on right now. The musical The Fantastics features two feuding fathers who aren't really feuding after all. In this song from Act Two, they hope for wonderful things to come out of the marriage of their two children, but they're not quite sure. The song is called Plant a Radish, and this song will be performed by Stu Sanford and Dave Davis.
Plant a radish, get a radish, never any doubt. That's why I love vegetables, you know what you're about.
Plant a turnip, get a turnip, maybe you'll get two. That's why I love vegetables, you'll know that they come through.
They're dependable,
they're befriendable.
They're the best pal a parent's ever known.
While with children, it's bewildering.
You don't know until the seed is nearly grown
just what you've sown. So plant a carrot, get a carrot, not a Brussels sprout.
That's why I love vegetables, you know what you're about. Life is merry if it's very vegetarian.
A man who plants a garden is a very happy man. Get a beanstalk, get a beanstalk, just the same as Jack. Then if you don't like it, you can always take it back.
But if your issue doesn't kiss you, then I wish you luck. For once you've planted children, you're absolutely stuck.
Every turnip green, every kidney bean, every plant grows according to the plot. While with progeny,
it's hot progeny. For as soon as you think you know what kind you've got,
it's what they're not. So plant
cabbage, get a cabbage,
not a sauerkraut.
That's why I love vegetables, you know what you're about. Life is merry
if it's very vegetarian.
A man who plants a garden is a very happy man. A vegetarian.
Very merry.
Vegetarian.
Our next guest tonight is a very familiar face here at the Playhouse. You've seen her in many, many shows, all kinds of different roles. Miss Jessica Ulbrich, how are you tonight?
I am wonderful. Thank you so much for asking me to be a part of this.
What was your first show that you did here on our stage?
My very first show was The Full Monty.
Okay.
And I played Estelle.
A little quiet, demure,
yes,
little
quiet,
part.
Yes, quiet, demure Estelle. Mm-hmm. Yes, very similar to my personality.
What other roles have you done in the years since then?
I have been lucky enough to do Les Mis as Eponine. I was recently Florence in Chess the Musical. I got to play Catherine in Pippin. I've gotten to do a lot of dream roles right on this stage.
What is your opinion or your thought? You've done shows at other theaters, mm-hmm. too. What's the appeal of the shows at Francis Wilson, or being in the shows at Francis Wilson Playhouse?
Well, the shows at Francis Wilson feel so professional. Even when I come to see a show at Francis Wilson, it's like, awes me every single time. But also, when you're here, I mean, it's a little Olive Garden, but when you're here, you're family. You know what I mean?
Olive Garden, yeah.
Yeah, when you're here, you're family. TM, TM, TM. But you walk into this theater, and it doesn't matter. I mean, Chess was my first time back on the stage since, I think, Wedding Singer, mm-hmm. and it felt like I was back home again. So it just always feels like
we aim for that. We like for that to happen. We do.
The biggest show ever on our Playhouse stage was our production of Les Miserables with a cast of 51 actors. In our show, the role of Eponine was played by Jessica Ulbrich. And tonight she's going to recreate her Act Two song, On My Own.
And now I'm all alone again, nowhere to turn, no one to go to. Without a home, without a friend, without a face to say hello to. And now the night is near, and I can make believe he's here. Sometimes I walk alone at night when everybody else is sleeping. I think of him and then I'm happy with the company I'm keeping. The city goes to bed and I can live inside my head. On my own, pretending he's beside me. All alone, I walk with him till morning. Without him, I feel his arms around me. And when I lose my way, I close my eyes and he has found me. In the rain, the pavement shines like silver. All the lights are misty in the river. In the darkness, the trees are full of starlight, and all I see is him and me forever and forever. And I know it's only in my mind that I'm talking to myself and not to him. And although I love him, but when the night is over, he is gone. The river's just a river. Without him, the world around me changes. The trees are barren everywhere. The streets are full of strangers. I love him.
My next guest tonight is a good friend of mine and a good friend of the Francis Wilson Playhouse. His name is Austin Gresham. How are you, Austin?
I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
All right. So what was your first show here at the Playhouse?
My first show was Les Mis. Mm-hmm. And I remember I came in, I think, a month after you guys had started the process of the show, and you were blocking Act One. I showed up that night, and you said, get on stage and just
get on stage.
Join the cast. And that was it. I went up there and I was like, okay.
And at that time, we were replacing all the seats in the auditorium, so there were no seats in the theater. Yep. So he's coming in for the first time, and there's no seats, and we're all laying on picnic blankets.
Yeah,
and
I remember that. Yeah.
But you fit right in.
Yeah.
And When Was She Loves Me, was that right after that?
That was. Yeah, that was in December.
He played Arpad in She Loves Me.
Many years ago.
What are some of your favorite roles you've done here?
Les Mis, I wasn't like a big part in that, but like Les Mis, it doesn't matter what part you are, it's an amazing show to be in. So I remember that show a lot. And what was it? She Loves Me was really fun because I was terrified because riding that bike on stage every night.
Yeah, that's true.
I always thought I was going to fall off. But that and also doing Hello, Dolly.
Barnaby Tucker.
Yeah, that was fun.
That was a great show. It was a great show. So you went off to school?
I did.
And you started the New York thing, and you had to top up for a little bit because of what's going on right now.
Yeah, I went to, in 2017, I left and went to the Boston Conservatory at Berkeley. And about 2019, I did two years there, I left and moved to New York. And then soon after moving to New York, coronavirus happens. So I left and came back home, and I've been home ever since.
Over the 30 years, the theater has produced many productions of Gilbert and Sullivan musicals. But I think we had the most fun in our last production of The Pirates of Penzance. Here, reprising his role as Frederick, is our very own Austin Gresham.
Does not feel the moral beauty of making worldly interests subordinate to sense of duty. Who would not give up willingly a matrimonial ambition to rescue such one as I from his unfortunate position, from his position, to rescue such a one as I from his unfortunate. Oh, is there not one maiden here whose homely face and bad complexion have caused a hope to disappear of ever winning man's affection? To such a one, if such there be, I swear by heaven's arch above you, if you will cast your eyes on me, however plain you be, I'll love you. Cast your eyes on me, however plain you be, I'll love you, I'll love you, I'll
All right, I have with me tonight two of our younger stars of our shows here. We have Mr. Drew Street and Cheyenne Haley, and we're going to talk a little bit about their experiences growing up, in a way, here at the Francis Wilson Playhouse. In a little bit, they're going to do a couple songs from Very Good Eddie, which is a show we talked about earlier, the very first show we've ever done here back in 91, the first musical. Now, what's your first show you did here?
Well, my first show I did here, I believe, was Seven Brides for Seven Brothers.
Yeah, Were you a bride or a brother?
I was a bride.
you were a townsperson.
I was actually neither. I was a suitor.
You were a suitor.
Yeah.
What about you, Cheyenne? What was your very first show here?
My first show, I was 9 years old. I was in Annie Get Your Gun, and I played the part of Jesse.
Jesse, okay. And you've both done a lot of roles since then. I sort of paired you up today because you've done some shows where you both were in it, like Into the Woods. Mm-hmm. You were Little Red Riding Hood. You were Jack from Jack and the Beanstalk. What's been some of your favorite parts, one of your favorite shows that you've done?
Well, I don't know. That's hard. I've done a lot. But I would have to say probably Joseph was definitely one of my favorites. I mean,
you were both in that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was fun.
Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. What about you, Cheyenne? What's one of your favorites?
I have a few favorites, but definitely one of the main ones would have to be Little Red Riding Hood from Into the Woods, definitely. And then I've done a lot of really fun ensemble roles here, right, like Pirates Penzance.
And concert. You both done concerts, yes. And you also were in Broadway Babies.
Yes.
And they all talked about the little girl. Well, so you started at 9, and what were you, 16, 15, 16 when you started here?
I think I was 17. It was the start of my senior year in high school.
And you're about to turn what age?
I don't even know. I'm 24 now, about to turn 25 in May.
And you were 9, and how old are you now?
I'm 20. I'll be 21 in March.
So you've been here 11 years. Yeah. You've been here a while. A few years back, we took a trip into the woods with a wonderful, wonderful cast here on our stage. Playing Little Red Riding Hood was our own Cheyenne Haley. And here's a song she sings after her encounter with the Big Bad Wolf. The song is entitled, I Know Things Now.
Mother said straight ahead, not to delay or be misled. I should have heeded her advice, but he seemed so nice. And he showed me things, many beautiful things that I hadn't thought to explore. They were off my path, so I never had dared. I had been so careful, I never had cared. Well, he made me feel excited, well, excited and scared. When he said, come in with that sickening grin, how could I what was in store? Though his teeth were bare, though I really got scared, well, excited and scared. But he drew me close and he swallowed me down, down a dark, slimy path where lie secrets that I never want to know. And when everything familiar seemed to disappear forever, at the end of the path was Granny once again. So we lay in the dark till you came and set us free, and you brought us to the light, and we're back at the start. Well, I know things now, many valuable things that I hadn't known before. Do not put your faith in a cape and a hood. They will not protect you the way that they should. And take extra care with strangers, even flowers have their dangers. Although scary is exciting, nice is different than good. Now I know, don't be scared, Granny is right, just be prepared. Isn't it nice to know a lot? And a little bit not.
One of the most colorful and fun shows in our history was the production of Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. In our production, Joseph was played by our own Drew Street. And here he sings the last big song he has in Act One, entitled Close Every Door to Me, with music by Andrew Lloyd Webber and lyrics by Tim Rice.
Close every door to me, hide all the world from me, bar all the windows and shut out the light. Laugh at me, darken my daytime, and torture my night. If my life were important, I would ask, will I live or die? but I know the answers lie far from this world. Close every door to me. Keep those I love from me. Children of Israel are never alone, for I know of my own. Just give me a number instead of my name. Forget all about me and let me. I'm only one person. Destroy me completely, then throw me away. If my life were important, I would ask, will I live or die? But I know the answers lie far from this world. Close every door to me. Keep the children of Israel are never alone, for we know we shall find our own peace of mind, for we have been promised a land of our
One of my favorite people in the world and in the theater world is Francesca Guancial-Jay. I'm sure you know Francesca from her many, many performances here at the Playhouse. And we go back many years before even the Francis Wilson Playhouse.
Yes, we do.
But what have been some of your favorite performances here, favorite roles here?
Favorite roles? Well, we can start back in 1996 with Esther in Meet Me in St. Louis.
Meet Me in St. Louis with a trolley on the stage.
With a trolley on the stage.
The trolley of death.
It was the trolley of death. That number of times it almost went into the orchestra pit and killed Brooke, the drummer.
But you made it.
We did make it. It was a lot of fun.
And then you were Dolly just a couple of years ago. And Hello, Dolly. I played a songwriter in Curtains. What are some of the other parts? You've done a lot of
things. Played The Witch.
The Witch in Into the Woods. We can't forget that. And then, of course.
Charlotte Cardoza in Titanic. Played Lily in
Secret Garden. And the mother of all mothers in It Should Have Been You.
Judy, I'm wearing the costume
there you
that
go.
I wore.
What makes performing here different than other venues that you've performed in?
The performance here is always so intimate, and you can actually see the first few rows, so you get that reaction. And on certain nights, we always know who's going to be sitting in the mm-hmm. seats, and it's always such a great thing to look down and know that, you know, certain people are going to be looking back up at you
right.
and smiling, and they always have your back. It's a very family-oriented place, backstage, on stage.
And you performed here with your husband and your daughter
I
in
have.
The same shows
I
with
have.
You.
It
and
has
we have
been
a lot of families. And Kristen Rao was here the other night, and her whole family grew up here. And what about out here in the auditorium? This is the lobby, sorry. Out here in the lobby after the show, when you talk to the people, what are some of the reactions you get?
Everybody loves it. Everybody loves coming here. Everybody loves the shows. They love the quality of the shows. I think that the quality of the shows here is always superb. And it's wonderful to talk to people, and we've met some very interesting people. During Titanic, we had people come through who were related
right,
to those
right.
who were on the Titanic. So it's been amazing to meet the people, and I like going out to the Joyed at Lines, as we call them, and talking to people and getting their reaction.
And they get to know the actors. They'll come to the box office. People will come and say, is so-and-so in the show? Or they'll come right in. A lot of people come right in and look at the picture board to see who's in the show. And they'll say, oh, and I'll eavesdrop on them saying, well, that's her daughter, and this is, and they'll point out the very various relationships, or they're married, and all that kinds of stuff. So,
and a number of times I've run into people outside of the theater, and they'll say, I saw you in at Francis Wilson.
The Playhouse had a rollicking hit with Jerry Herman's musical Hello, Dolly. And our Dolly Levi was none other than Francesca Guancial J. Here she's going to sing the Act One finale, Before the Parade Passes By.
Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get in step while there's still time left. Ephraim, let me go. It's been long enough, Ephraim. Every evening for all these years, I've put out the cat, I've locked the door, I've made myself a little rum toddy. And before I went to bed, I said a prayer thanking God that I was independent, that no one's life was mixed up with mine. Then one evening, an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you, Ephraim. A perfectly good oak leaf, but without color and without life. And I suddenly realized that I'm that oak leaf. For years, I've not shed one tear, nor have I been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. And so, I've decided to rejoin the human race, and Ephraim, I want you to give me away. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of just passing by life. With the rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again, I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by. Look at that crowd up ahead, listen and hear that brass harmony growing. Look at that crowd up ahead, pardon me if spirit is showing. All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton before the parade.
One of Broadway's funniest musicals is Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, which we produced here at the theater 10 years ago to the date. In this Act Two finale, Jerry Slutsky and Nathan Dougherty tell us just what dirty rotten scoundrels they are.
Jerry, it's been 10 years since we did Dirty Rotten Scoundrels on this stage. Can you believe that?
10 years.
10 years. It was my very first show here at the theater.
You were 19.
I was 19, and you were like, what, 86?
Almost. Okay. Almost. Got not it. Quite, but that was before I was on Medicare.
Okay, good. 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 Well, you know what? Let's see if we still have it after 10 years.
All
Emmy?
All right.
Let's do it.
One of the most fun shows I've ever done.
Me
Glad
too.
To share it with you.
Absolutely. Me too.
You may be master of your chosen occupation, with several strings of polo ponies in your stable. You must remember all the same that at the crux of every game is knowing when it's time to leave the table. And it's important to be artful in your exit. No turning back, you must accept the con is done. But now and then you might recall the moments when you had it all. You had the charm, you had the talent, and by God, you had some fun. It was a ball, it was a blast, it's a shame it couldn't last. But every chapter has to end, you must agree. It was a joy, it was sublime, a splendid way to earn a dime for a dirty, rotten guy like me.
You are dirty, rotten, Jerry.
Typecasting. When you look back on all your conquests and deceptions, you see a thousand flawless pearls set in a strand, laid out from Biarritz to Rome, each one as perfect as a poem, an opus to be proud of, though it's written in the sand. It was a ball, it was a thrill, you had the grace, you had the skill to know exactly what to say and what to do. You wouldn't trade a single day or have it any other way. A dirty, rotten guy like
it's
you.
Almost a religion, the need to take a pigeon and to play your part with elegance and zest. But when it's time to fold the act and your duffel bag is packed, take comfort in the fact that you've been working with the best. Ah! It was a blast, it was a ball, it was a gas. I loved it all because I was hanging with the man, and that's a plus.
Oh, Freddy, you're the nerve.
You've got the guts.
You've got the nerve.
You've got the nuts.
I guess we're dirty, rotten
crooks. We're dirty, rotten crooks.
Dirty, rotten guys.
Ah, it was a trip. It was a blast. It was a shame. It couldn't last because it was almost too prodigious to discuss.
So we got screwed for 50 grand.
I think we still deserve a hand. Dirty, rotten guys like us. We still got it, Jerry.
Nathan, you're awesome.
All of us here at the Playhouse hope you enjoyed this look behind the scenes at the actors and the performers that have helped make us strong. Of course, they are just as important as our audiences, and we hope to have you back here in person soon. But we're going to keep in touch with you online. We have a couple more concerts coming up in the year 2020. We have a wonderful Christmas concert coming up and a special New Year's Eve countdown concert as well. We thank you for supporting us, for donating to us, for your cards and letters that keep coming in, and we just can't have enough of it. And I thank all the wonderful talents that have worked here in the 90 years of the Playhouse, and especially in the 30 years that we've been doing musicals, and we hope to be doing it for many, many more years. Thank you and good night.